Welcome to my channel. My name is Precious Malaji. I trust that you guys are living the life that you want to live. I trust that you're happy with where you are in life. I trust that you're not giving a damn about what people think about you and you are living life the best way that you know how. Today, guys, I want to talk about the different types of tendering scams that are available in South Africa. It is very unfortunate that while other people are working hard for their money, other people are working hard to scam them from that money that they worked hard for. So today I just wanted to enlighten you and make you aware of the different types of scams that are available, the different types of scams that people use to scam you from to scam you to get your money from you as an entrepreneur. So for those who don't understand what tendering is a process where the government advertises or are in need when the government issues out a service. When the government is in need of a certain service or a product, they would advertise that they're in need of that product, and you as a supplier or as a tender, you as an entrepreneur or as a supplier who is interested in offering those services or product to the government will bid for that product or service. You know, that's just the entry level. It's not as easy as that. So that is what tendering is, you know. So the first type of scam is RFQs. You know, it is true that government does issue RFQs to prospective suppliers. You know, they will send you an email to request a quotation from you, and but unfortunately people are using this to scam you from your money, you know. So the RFQ system, how it works is that the scammer will send you an RFQ and you will respond to that RFQ, you know. And how this is expected to turn out is that the scammer sends you the RFQ, the request for quotation, you reply to it. In most cases, guys, with the RFQs, in most cases the specification is so complicated, like you cannot just get it at any shop, you know. The specification is not something that you can just walk in a shop and just get it, you know. It's normally something very complicated. Like, it's just numbers, it's just, you know, it's just very, very complicated. You are going to be needing to search on Google or on the web to find a service provider for such a service, you know. So what the scammers expect you, how the scammers expect you to react is that you're going to search for the product that you need and you're going to be getting a supplier. And in most cases, the supplier is your, I'm not even going to say, the supplier is very far from you. So if you are in Mpumalanga, the supplier would be maybe in Cape Town or in Durban or whatever, but it's going to be a very long distance, a distance where you cannot just walk into a shop and just check if those things are available. When you search on the website, the first thing that you're going to see on that supplier is exactly the specification as it should be. You're obviously going to be happy about this, but guys, that the website belongs to the scammers. You know, that website is developed by the scammers. When you call this number, they're going to be giving you the request, the quotation as you want it, as per spec, and they are going to offer you free delivery of free shipping to any province. You know, that's the first red light. I mean, free shipping, what the fuck? You know, who gives you free delivery, you know? And the another thing that you should spot with these supplies is that they do not have a VAT number. They are selling equipment that is very expensive, but they don't have a VAT number. That's not possible in South Africa. You know, the moment you reach 1 million rands, it is mandatory for you to register for VAT. And if you do not register, somehow SARS is going to pick it up and you will be forced to register for VAT, you know. So how this is expected to play out: you request a quotation, they give you a quotation, you deliver or you send your quotation to the person who requested the RFQ, which is the government. And guys, another thing is that the email address is just so messed up. If you can just check the email address of the person who's requesting the quotation, it just doesn't make sense, you know. It in most cases it's alphabet that would make sense. And if you know the government websites and the government email address, you are able to pick this up very fast, that okay, this email address does not exist, you know. That's normally the first giveaway for a fraudulent or a scammer's request for quotation. And also, when you look at the document itself, if you are someone who's familiar with tender documents and tender document pricing and compiling, you realize that the layout of the document is just not as we're used to, because in most cases the government uses a standard template for all their RFQs, you know. So Another thing is that the moment you submit this quotation to the person who's requesting the quotation, the appointment is so quick. And we all know, guys, we all work with government at some point. We all know how long sometimes the processes take. You know, the process has to go through a certain evaluation. Sometimes it does not go through a thorough evaluation, but it is impossible for you to submit a quotation today and get a purchase order within an hour, you know. So normally with the scammers, the moment you submit the quotation or the documentation, they give you an hour. After an hour, they appoint you as a service provider and they expect you to deliver in a very short period of time because they need to get the money from you as quick as they can. The moment they appoint you as a service provider, you're obviously going to, you have to pay your supplier now. The moment you pay your supplier, that's where it ends, guys. You're not going to get any delivery. You're not going to be able to, like, it just does not exist. You have been scammed. And in most cases, it's a lot of money. It's not just 50,000 rand, 30,000 rand, the RFQs that you're used to. It's a lot of money. So, guys, you really need to be careful of these types of scams. How to spot if something is genuine, guys? As I said, when you look at a document, in most cases, if you are familiar with documents, tender documents, you'll see that this thing does not make sense. The structure, you can see that this thing is just made up. The structure of everything just does not make sense. The phone number does not make sense. The email address does not make sense. The best way to check if someone on RFQ or an RFQ is genuine is by actually calling the said department or government institution. And when you call, you do not use the number that is listed on the tender document or wherever. You need to Google, search on Google. If it's Department of Water Affairs, search Department of Water Affairs, tell contact details, call that number. Don't call the number on the document because obviously, guys, you are going to reach the scammer's number, you know, and obviously they're going to verify if this is correct. So you search Department of Water and Sanitation or whatever. You call them and you just check if the person who sent you the RFQ does work for that government. And if they do work for that government, if there is such an RFQ that has been issued or that has been advertised, you know, that is the best way that you can find out if something is genuine. Also, the email address, guys, the email address is always a giveaway, you know. So please be very, very careful of that. The second way that people, scammers, use to scam you or get money from you is getting into a mind database, you know. It's crazy because in most cases it is so impossible, it is so difficult to get into a mind, to get into a mind database. And in most cases, unfortunately, you will have to pay someone to get into a vendor database. And scammers are using this to their advantage. So how this normally works is that someone will call you and tell you that there's a job at whatever mine and you need to be there maybe tomorrow morning. And in most cases, guys, this thing sounds so real, you know, this thing sounds so real. And sometimes they even use a landline. And when you call the mine, when you call the said mine, you will find that that person who calls you does really work for that mine. So they call you and tell you that, okay, look, man, there's a job that needs to be awarded tomorrow. The said supplier is not pitching. So we urgently need someone, we urgently need a company like yours to come and take over the contract. urgently. I mean, guys, who does not want to get into a mine database, you know? So when you get to these people, in most cases, they want you to somehow pay them, you know? And when you pay them, guys, obviously, it's gone, you know? So if you want to get into a database of a mine, you need to go there or ask to speak to the relevant person. Unfortunately, guys, that's how it is. Getting into a database of a mine is not a walk in the park, you know, and getting in genuinely, like, cleanly and professionally is just so difficult. I've been trying to get into mine databases for I don't know how many years now. more years than I've been in business. That's how long I've been trying to get into a database. So when you get to the person, so the person, they tell you that, okay, be at this and this mine at this amount of, at 8 o'clock in the morning, we need to draft a contract quickly for you so that you start working. Okay, guys, because you need a job, you're going to be driving to Witbank or wherever where the mine is, and you're going to be expecting to meet this person who's going to give you the vendor database, you know. But when you get there, they tell you that, okay, you know what, don't get into the mine, because this thing is something that we are doing under secret. Number one red flag, guys. And actually, the first red flag that you should be wary about, guys, if you did not apply for something, if you did not apply for a certain tender, How the hell do you expect to get a tender if you have not attempted to register at a certain mine? How the hell do you expect for you to get into a mine if you have not registered? So guys, if you have not applied for anything, if you have not worked for something, just avoid it by all costs. I mean, I think that's the best way to avoid scams. So let's say you get to the mine at 8 a.m. We're going to be signing the contract. Just bring us your document. When you get there, they tell you, okay, wait, don't go in. We need you to fill in these documents. And after you fill in, we'll be able to draft the document, the contract. As you'll be, you know, scrambling to fill in the forms, they'll tell you that, okay, wait now. We are having a problem with your contract. There's a certain group of people who want you to actually prove that you'll be able to service them nicely. Because guys, we all know that these days connections work, you know. So they tell you that these people are holding back from signing the contract because they want you to actually pay something, guys. The moment you have to pay for something in advance, especially something as free as vendor registration or a tender. Getting a tender is actually free. You don't have to pay anyone, you know. So the moment someone tells you that you need to pay this amount to get this amount, that is a red flag, run, you know. That is how they scam you. And in most cases, guys, these people do use Muti. So you really need to be careful. And again, in a mind sense, calling the mind to find out what's happening is the best way that you can save yourself. You know, call the mine, find out if this person, Stan or whatever, is working for that mine. And if he is working for the mine, request to talk to him and hear him out. You know, in most cases, these scammers use genuine information. Like when you check the information, you're going to get that the information is correct. But it is up to you to actually protect yourself and, you know, protect your money. The third way that scammers use to get to you and your money is that they use the municipal manager for municipalities. You know, you normally get, let's say, and in most cases, this one is tricky because in most cases, you have bidded for the tender. You did bid for the tender. Let's say there was a tender closing on Friday and the tender was for supply of cups, you know. It's supply of cups and you bid, the tender is closed, you know. These scammers are able to get that information. That information is public. I mean, in most cases, when you submit a tender, there is a register that you fill in. And somehow people are able to take pictures or take information from the tender submission and try to scam people. So you submit the tender for delivery of cups, and someone the following week is calling you and telling you that, okay, I am representative of the MM. MM is the municipal manager. The municipal manager wants to offer you this job, but they need you to pay this amount of money before you are able to get this job. Guys, come on. Come on. Unfortunately, you know, it's tricky because unfortunately these things happen. But as I said, the moment you have to pay for something in advance, it becomes a red flag, you know. You must really, really, like, that's a big risk. So I wouldn't advise you to pay for anything in advance, be it a job, be it a vendor registration, be it anything that you should be actually benefiting from, you know. If someone needs you to pay money, let it be after you've received whatever it is that you are supposed to receive, you know. Doing business with the state, guys, is very beneficial. I mean, if you are able to secure a good contract or a good job with government, I mean, that's a lot of capital for you. I would advise everyone to go into tendering because the capital that is involved in like the capital that you are going to be receiving at once is a lot. The government is the best customer, you know. It's the best customer because you'll be investing for a very a big amount of money in a short amount of space. But then again, you need to be careful on your dealings. Be careful of the people you meet. Be careful if you have to be paying money. Be careful on how you thread and how you actually execute the job and the people around you. You know, the moment you get a job, there will be people who are trying to get money from you somehow. But then it's important for you to be careful, guys. Just be careful of your surroundings. Be careful of the dealings that you have. Be careful of your. I mean, if you're a business person, in most cases, your contact details are everywhere. But then just be careful, like, just be mindful of the information that you give away. Be mindful of your conversation. Be mindful, like, in most cases, guys, no one is going to give you a job just like that. It does not happen. It just does not happen. You need to apply for the job. You need to apply for the job. It's not going to arrive as manna from heaven. With that said, guys, thank you so much for watching this video. I hope I was able to teach you a thing or two about tendering and what you need to look out for, because guys, people are actually losing a lot of money with these scams, because people are so desperate to get 3-year contracts, people are so desperate to get jobs, because who does not want to do business with the government? I mean, guys, government is the best and biggest customer that you can have in South Africa. So I would advise you to do tendering, but just be careful on who you deal with, how you deal with, and when. Thank you so much for watching this video, guys. Please don't forget to give this video a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe, and don't forget to share this with any business person who is a tenderer, who is tendering, who is interested in doing business with the government, or who is interested in raising capital. The best way to raise capital, guys, is by doing business with the government. So I do advise you to tender, but also be cautious. Bye.